Daniel did not want to eat the king's rich food and wine because it will make him unclean. So he asked, this is one of those names, Ashpenaz, and he was the king chief of the official. He asked Ashpenaz for permission not to make himself unclean in this way. Father, I pray for you, Lord, to open our hearts and our minds, Lord, to your word. And I know, Lord, that your word is blessed. And I know that your word, Lord, comes to our hearts and speak to our spirit, Lord. So thank you, Lord. Prepare us, Lord, to hear it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. When you can't see God's hand. When you can't see God's hand, we ask questions like, is really there a God that I can approach and trust? Is he loving? Is he good? Is he good only with the good people? Because I don't think I deserve to approach him. Is he really care? When things go fine in our lives, we won't find it hard to believe in God. To believe in a God that is good and a God that loves us. It's not hard to believe that. It's easy. But if something devastating has recently happened to us that make us ask, how could a loving God allow this to happen to me? Oh, how? And today I think that Daniel's story is going to help us understand better. Daniel loved God with all his heart. Daniel was a hardcore believer of God. But something devastating happened to him. To understand better this story, we need to go back way time when God requests the people, his people. Let me rewind the time. We have to go all the way back to the time when God he rescued his people and told his people these words. If you guys, and I'm just putting modern words so we can understand it better. If you guys live the way I tell you to live and obey my commands, you are going to get blessed. But if you turn your back to me and follow other gods, you are going to be in a world of hurt. Then the people did what we do most of the time when someone said, don't turn back, don't look down to the steep, don't touch, don't eat that apple. We turn back, we look down, we touch, we eat the apple, we do the opposite of the don't do it. Have you been in car expositions with signs that said, don't touch? If you see fingerprints around, probably can be some of mine. Sadly, most people choose to turn their back to God, to give their back to God. And like everything we do wrong and in disobedience in life, it brings consequences. I remember when I was a kid and grandmom said, don't do that. And when she won't see me, I said, yes, I do. Then when grandpa, he got home, well, I paid the consequences. He tanned me. He changed my color. The same with the people of Israel. As a consequence of not following God, instruction, God allowed the people to be judged. God allowed the consequences to follow them. That is what happened when Daniel was a teenager. One day in Jerusalem, Daniel was captured as the consequences of the bad decision of the people, not as consequences of his decision. Because our bad decisions doesn't only affect us, but affect people around us. People that is innocent, our bad decisions in life can affect so many people. Saying that, let me move to the story. So one day in Jerusalem, Daniel, he was captured in his enemy's net. And his world got turned upside down. Maybe some of you remember the sermon I preached on August 28th, slide 2, please. And maybe you don't remember the sermon, but that's okay. The sermon title was Life in Motion, based on Psalm 137, verse 1 to 6. And if you don't remember, let me know so I can preach it right now. And then I continue preaching this message. Well, that day I play a song, Rivers of Babylon by Bonnie M. And some of you, I think, know it, and some of you didn't, but now you know it because you hear it. Now, during that sermon, I mentioned that the writer of Psalm 137 begins his psalm remembering that Jerusalem has been attacked and conquered, and the temple destroyed, and his people was being taken prisoner and away from their home. Slide 3, please. Now, Babylon's war plans, plan of war was to attack and conquer, obviously, right? But Babylon's war plan was to dismantle the power that Israel had, dismantle the power base in Israel, so that that the people of Israel wouldn't be able to rebuild. And their strategy were to dismantle the power. And in order to dismantle the power of Israel, they capture and they destroy all their leaders. They capture and destroy leaders. But also they kept some leaders. They destroy the organization's skills. They destroy everything they can use to rebuild and come back in power. Jerusalem has been defeated, has been ravaged. Their homes has been plundered, pillaged, burned. Many of their family members and friends die during that struggle. And the ones that survived, they were taken against their will, captured. They were removed from their homes, from their land, from their city, from their place that they know. They were taken away from their temple. They were sent to a complete godlessness place. And Daniel was one of them, one of the captives. Slide 4, please. Daniel's captors were working a strategy. They select the best young people. Next slide, please. The best people they selected. People like the all-American teenagers with the highest SAT scores and the ones voted the MVP, the most likely to succeed. They select them. And Daniel was one of them. Daniel was on their list. The Babylonians brought them to their capital city, the near modern city of Kuwait. They said, "We are going to brainwash these kids and teach them to learn our program and teach them to be like us." So, Daniel was given a new name. Slide, please. And the name was Belteshazzar, and was forced to learn a new language, a culture. He was feeling like those that go to places and see signs saying, "We speak English only." They were feeling quiet. They caught their wings. Forced to learn new language, new culture. They even got a new diet for him. That was a shock. Just imagine yourself put in that situation, in Daniel's situation for a moment. It's not easy. It's hard. I'm just thinking a little bit about him. They changed his diet. Monday, Friday, Thursday, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday and Friday. He had sandwiches instead of tacos and food from the pig and the chicken. I'm sorry, I have a Freudian moment. Some kind of trauma came to my brain. Something that I lived up about a week ago. But okay, Juan, behave. Andili. So he was forced to change his life. I was not forced to change it, okay? I changed it because I like it. I have a lot of fun there. So let me try to think. Let me try to return to my path. Sometimes my brain goes to places that shouldn't go, on the moment that shouldn't go there. Some of you may be saying, what are you talking about, Pastor? But some people here know what I'm talking about. Taco Bell's time. No, glorious food time. Well, Daniel was forced to learn new language, new culture, new diet. And here we see the turn of this story. Slide 7, please. Scripture, Daniel, in Daniel chapter 1, verse 8, said again, Daniel did not want to eat the king's rich food and wine because it will make him unclean. He didn't want to eat it because it made him unclean. So Daniel did not want to eat it, even though the food was rich, even though there was a great wine. And the reason he didn't want to accept it is because he knew that as that food were offered to their gods, that food were in some way touched by or connected with idolatry. And he worshiped only one God. He worshiped only one God. And just when things were heading downhill, just when all the people of Israel started giving their backs to God because a lot of bad stuff were happening to them, God found a person who would stand for him. And that person was Daniel. Daniel said, my world just got rocked, but I am all for God. I won't do that thing that will dishonor him. I won't dishonor him. I honor God. He know his heart, and he know that his God was over everything and all his desires in life. It's like if the Gators win a game against the Seminoles, the hardcore Seminoles would not change their team for the other because Seminoles got defeated by the mighty Gators. Win or lose, being the best or the worst, I'm a hardcore Dallas Cowboy, and I know the Cowboys have been doing a good job recently. And I'm their fan for life. As well, I'm a Gator. I confess it. The same, a hardcore Seminole is a Seminole for life. Win or lose, even though they win sometimes more than Gators.
But Gators also are hardcore. That's why Seminoles are Seminoles, Gators are Gators. Hardcore fans, and never quit or leave their teams. Well, Daniel was a hardcore believer of God. Daniel was committed to God. If Daniel had decided what God was like by looking at his circumstances, he would have become a disillusioned, confused, angry young man, ripped from his homeland, forced into slavery, most likely castrated to become a eunuch in the palace. Nonetheless, Daniel still had his eyes on God. Imagine the suffering, the pain connected with his circumstances. And yet, slide 8, please. Daniel went through the fire successfully. And you can do. You can go through the fire of your trials successfully, the same way Daniel did. I'm sure if any of us were in Daniel's place, we must have wondered, next slide, God, where are you? We know the outcome of his life, but at that time, Daniel, he didn't know what will happen. He didn't know. It's easy for us to say, God, I'm going to follow you the same way Daniel followed you. But Daniel didn't know. And he did. He did. Notice how God was working. First, God was working in this way. First, he was the very one who allowed the captivity to take place as a consequence of the disobedience of his people. But next, God caused Ashpenaz, the man in charge of the officials, to be kind and loyal to Daniel. God used this man. God put in the heart of this man. God used someone to be there for Daniel. And not only that, God gave to Daniel and his friend, God gave these four young men we see in the Bible superior wisdom, the ability to learn many different kinds of writings and science. And then you could also understand all kinds of visions and dreams. God empowered them. God put someone with a heart to help them, and also God empowered them. The sovereign unfolding of Daniel's life did not happen by accident, because God was at work. If you think in your circumstances, if I think in the circumstances I have been, always someone has been there for me. Always something happened because God prepared the way for me. The same way in your lives, when you have gone through difficult and hard situations, you have seen the light because God has been working through someone. The same way God has been working through you to help someone else, to give a word of encouragement, to extend the hand, to be there. Or to be there in presence. God was at work. It was not an accident. Do you see how foolish we are when we deny God's hand just because we can't see him? We are foolish. In our teeny, tiny corner of this planet, in a massive universe that God has made, we stand in our arrogance and said, because bad things are happening, there can be no God. Or we said, he can't be loving or powerful or in control.
And many times the bad things that happen is because of our own bad decisions and actions in life. Slide one, please. Do you recognize that map? That's our planet. Callahan, Florida, and our planet. That's our solar system. Where is the Earth? Somewhere over there. Follow the green arrow. Where we are. Where is our solar system? Next slide. Follow the arrow and you have an idea. Where is our solar system? That's the Oort cloud. Somewhere beyond, somewhere so far away, where there is no way for us to see Callahan, Florida, United States, American continent, Earth, solar system. I'm going to rewind the tape and say it again. Do you see how foolish we are when we deny God's hand just because we can't see Him? In our teeny tiny corner of this planet, in a massive universe that God had made, we stand in our arrogance and said, because bad things are happening, there can be no God, or he can't be loving, or he can't be in control. How small we can be to think that we can somehow eliminate God because we can't figure out life mysteries and life mysteries. Today, church, I want to tell you, love the Lord with all your heart. Love the Lord, the creator of heavens and earth, the creator of the universe, the one that keep in constant perfect balance our planet, our solar system, the earth cloud, and beyond. The one that sent his son Jesus Christ to give us life, to rescue us from our sins, to be with us in the times of sorrow, trials, temptations, to be in our side. God loves us so much that he knows each one of us by name, and he gives special attention when we are in need. God, the creator of this massive universe, mega universe, loves you, cares for you, loves you the way you are, with your perfections, with your imperfections, and with the worst of you. If you have been asking, God loves me, yes, God loves you. If you've been asking, is he loving? Yes, God is a loving God. Is he good? Is he good only with the good people, because I don't think I deserve him to approach? Yes, he, our God, is good, and he loves you the way you are, and he wants you to approach him. Is he really care? Yes, he cares. God cares for you. He has been caring for you since you were created in your mother's womb. Church, friends, brothers, sisters, know that God is at work in your life and in your situation, in our teeny tiny world. Somewhere beyond the earth cloud is our solar system, is planet Earth. Is America continent. Is Florida. It's Callahan, is our church. Is God seeing at every one of us? And is hearing our prayers? Is hearing our voices? Is hearing our cry? And he's telling you, it is telling us, I care for you. I'm at work. I'm at work. I love you the same way I love Daniel. I'm with you the same way I was with Daniel in the fire of the furnace. I love you and I'm with you the same way I was with Daniel on the den of lions. That's the truth, brothers and sisters. God is with us. Trust him. He's at work in your life. Amen. Father, we come to your presence, and I know, Lord, that there is a lot of needs. And I know, Lord, that we go through so much. But I know, Father, that you call us. You call us, Lord, and we respond to you. We said, yes, Lord, here I am. And I love you, Lord. And I will follow you because I'm a hardcore believer. And I won't accept, Lord, the food and the wine of the King. I just accept your blessings. I live for you, Lord. I'm a believer. My life is yours. I'm your son. I'm your daughter. I'm your child. And I will follow you, Lord. And I will believe you. Even though if I'm seeing the skies fall down on me, I will believe you. And I will stay with you until my last breath of life. Because I know, Lord, that you are at work. I know, Lord, that you are working in my life, that you are making me better, that you are changing me, that you are using me for good, to bless others. Thank you, Lord, because you love us so much that you sent your Son to save us, to give us hope, to let us know that you are at work in our lives. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, I pray. Amen.
We have several prayer and praise requests today. Here's one from Marie. Says she's still struggling with some health issues, and she knows that God is always with her, and she asks you to please pray for this world and Pastor Sue and her family. Marie also says, thank you for my family of First United Methodist Church. Your prayers and concern and support and giving, they are, she says, there is joy in knowing that, and says how grateful she is. Thank you. Sorry? Thank you. And then Jennifer says, continued prayer for our niece Tiffany and her two kids for the loss of her husband and our family, and that justice would be done for his murder. Patsy is requesting prayer for surgery on her eyes. It's going to be September 29th and October 13th. Just wants prayers and knows that you'll support her. Patsy also is requesting prayer for Nancy Ash and family. Her mother is very ill. And now a praise from Randy. His daughter Melanie is 12 years old today. And Cheryl asks for prayers for our nation and prayers for our church and ends with praise God. Pastor?
Also, please keep Lorraine in the prayers. She's flying tomorrow, coming back home. And that's a good thing, right? Yeah. Heavenly Father, we lift to you our prayers, our concerns. But Lord, before that, there is a great thanksgiving in our hearts for all the great and good things that you do for us, for keeping us safe, for providing for every need of us, for giving us life and giving us health, Lord, for being with us during times of difficulty, times of trials, times of temptations, times, Lord, when we feel lonely, when we feel that no one cares, times when things don't go the way we need or we want, you've been there, Lord. And I know, Father, as a fact that you will be with us in any moment that we need you. That's why we lift to you these concerns, these needs, these prayers. We pray, Lord, for healing, healing to our bodies, healing to our minds, healing to our souls, healing to our spirit. Healing, Lord, to our relationships, healing to our land. We pray, Lord, for unity. We pray, Lord, for a vision. We pray for growth, growth in all the ways we can spiritually. Also for growth in our church. And today, Lord, we lift this to you. And today, Lord, we said that we trust in you. And we know, Lord, that you're going to take care of every need that we have. All these prayers are lifted to you, Lord, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.